before I answer your direct question, I do want to say one thing about kind of the practice of writing, right? So I can't remember if it was Frost or Hemingway who said, rule number one for writing, place ass in chair. So I think that's important.
And welcome to this episode of the Academy Management Review Origin Series. My name is Rich McAdock. I am an associate editor at AMR and your host for this series. My guest today is Russ McBride, who will be discussing his forthcoming AMR manuscript called Social Objectivity and Entrepreneurial Opportunities. And this article was co-authored with Rob Wuebker. So Russ, welcome to the Origin Series.
Thanks for having me. I'm honored.
Great. So why don't you start us off by giving us just kind of a brief overview of the paper itself, the kind of the elevator pitch version in a minute or two. What's the problem that you're trying to solve and what solution are you proposing?
Yeah. So there's the apparent problem and then there's our secret hidden agenda. So the apparent problem is the debate within entrepreneurship about whether entrepreneurial opportunities are discovered or whether they are created. And this has been going on for a long time. And there have been numerous discussions around it. So for us, the secret agenda was, you know, not this debate itself, but to use this debate as an application point for a what we view as a better understanding of how social reality works. So, you know, from my perspective, if the paper was only the first six pages, that would have been good enough for me. That's where we lay out what I take to be a reasonable understanding and framework for how to understand how social reality works and what social objectivity really is. And then using that framework, we then apply it to this debate. So it's really the framework for understanding social reality that I think is the important point, and it can be applied to all sorts of things.
Great. So let's dig a little bit deeper into that. So what is social reality? What is social objectivity? And how does that help us to understand the meaning of entrepreneurial opportunities?
Yeah, all very reasonable questions. So one would think that at this point, we would have a basic framework for how to understand the social world. You know, there's a schism that many of us have just grown so accustomed to that we don't really acknowledge it anymore. And that is that, you know, the natural sciences have a robust, firm, well-established, consensual agreement about how the natural world works and what the basic theories are. And so, you know, if you're talking to a physicist, you know, he doesn't get into too many arguments with the chemists, you know, or the geologists, because they all agree to this basic framework within the natural sciences that works really well and allows for a great deal of progress and knowing exactly, you know, where the end of that framework is, where the edges of those theories are, and where you're pushing the boundaries to try and create new knowledge. Unfortunately, in the social sciences, and by social sciences, I mean sociology, anthropology, you know, management, strategy, law, social psychology, we don't have a universal framework, right, that we all agree upon. And so what we do to the best of our ability is to work on the pieces that we are typically operating on as best as we can with the theories and the frameworks and the tools that we've adopted from the people in our field as best as we can. So you would think at this point that we'd have a unified framework for social theory, and you'd think that maybe at the beginning sociology would have created such a unified framework instead of conceptual tools. But you know, the fact is, you know, Durkheim and Weber were much more concerned to establish sociology as an independent field apart from psychology than to put in the work to try and really build a unified framework. And it's, you know, it's incredibly hard work. So the people that have been trying to do that are first and foremost, the Cambridge Social Ontology Group, which included Roy Baskar when he was alive and Margaret Archer and Tony Laws and other folks, but also lots of work from people that we call social ontologists, right? The social ontology movement or collective intentionality movement folks, especially John Searle at UC Berkeley, Raimo Tuomela, formerly at the University of Finland, Margaret Gilbert, Kirk Ludwig, who's at the University of Indiana, Brian Epstein at Tufts, and other folks. So we have lots of you know, really smart people around the world, mostly in social ontology and also in critical realism, who are trying to build a unified framework for understanding social reality. Now, in the paper, I take a really simple view to all of this, but I think it's an important one because there have been so many problems in the past talking about theories and trying to make progress that where the physical world is conflated with the social world. So on the really straightforward approach that we're taking in the paper, we can distinguish the social world from the physical world because the physical world is mind independent, right? It doesn't matter what you think about a hydrogen atom, it's there, it does its thing. It doesn't care, you know, the moon doesn't care what you think about it. It's there, it's still got its craters and its dust. But, you know, as it turns out, the capital of France does care what you think about it, right? So we all believe the capital of France is Paris, but if everybody woke up tomorrow morning and believed that Marseille, you know, or Nice, was the capital of France, then that would actually be the capital of France. And that's the difference between social phenomena and physical phenomena. So social phenomena are mind dependent and physical phenomena are mind independent. And that has all sorts of consequences.
So opportunities are social phenomena.
Yeah. So pretty much everything we do, right, in management and entrepreneurship and strategy, OB, you know, it's we're all dealing with social phenomena. So we have this problem, and we have a complaint from the discovery theorists. And the giant problem is, well, okay, how do you understand how something can be socially objective? We understand how the moon can be objective, right, because it's mind independent, it's out there doing its thing, whatever we think about it. But how, if everything in the social world is mind dependent, how can you ever have objective social phenomena? So how do you ever get to the point where you have, you know, the government of Canada or, you know, the capital of Paris or, you know, a company like Apple? These are all objective social phenomena, unlike, you know, say Santa Claus. So what's the difference between socially objective phenomena and socially subjective phenomena, right? So this, you know, why ask this question? Well, one reason to ask this question is because we have this giant debate about one particular social phenomenon, which is the entrepreneurial opportunity, right? And the debate is it objective or subjective? So, the first thing to realize is that all physical phenomena are ontologically objective and all social phenomena are ontologically subjective. That is, their very existence, what they are, depends upon the minds of people. So it's ontologically subjective, whereas the moon is ontologically objective. So if, you know, one of the complaints from the discovery theorists is that, hey, if everything is subjective, like I just admitted, then nothing can be objective. We know money is objective. You know, how much money you have in your bank account is objective. And if you want to test that it's actually just subjective and, you know, a matter of random opinion, you can go to your bank manager and ask them to make sure the number in your bank account balance is 10 times what it says it is currently. And they will definitely not assent to your request, right? So in a sense, it's objective. So in what sense is it objective? That's the question. And I think, you know, all the discovery theorists and Peter Klein's got a quote about money being objective, and part of the problem with constructionist views is that everything's subjective, so money must be subjective too. And, you know, he's right, and the discovery theorists are right, because the folks on the constructionist side have not said what it means for a social phenomena to be objective. So there's kind of a big hole, right? There's a big hole in this approach. How do you understand how social phenomena can ever be objective? And so that's what we try to do in the paper. We say, hey, once you break this question about entrepreneurial opportunities into two different questions, one about the ontology, and that one we can answer really quickly. You know, natural phenomena are ontologically objective, social phenomena are ontologically subjective. And break it down into another question about the epistemology. So on the epistemology side, this is where it's possible to get epistemologically objective phenomena. What does that mean? What is epistemology? What is ontology? Ontology is the study of what things are. And epistemology is how we know what things are, really. So epistemology is about knowledge, and ontology is about the things themselves about which we can have knowledge of. So ultimately, just to jump to the chase, the answer to the question about how you get social objectivity is by means of epistemological objectivity. And how do you get epistemological objectivity? Well, what does that even mean? It just means, hey, how do we get to the point where our knowledge about something is objective and certain? And the main answer from the people who are doing the most work on this problem in social ontology is that it's deontics and beliefs. So the capital of France is Paris, because the people who are in the positions of appropriate authority, as well as everybody else, as it turns out, believe that Paris is the capital of France. So we have the belief component. Now, in lots of other things, the deontic component is really important too. So what are deontics? Deontics are just rights and duties, right? So if, you know, I got married tomorrow, a new social entity would come into existence. And that social entity, on the standard view in social ontology, is a social entity because of the deontics that it possesses. So right when the minister says, I hereby declare you husband and wife, you know, what comes into existence is all sorts of rights and responsibilities. So the two people now have the responsibility to provide and make medical decisions on behalf of their partner should an emergency come up. There are all sorts of tax implications. You get discounts for couples at your local gym.
Joint ownership of assets.
Joint ownership of assets, exactly. So I feel like I've talked too much. So does that make sense, or am I?
Yeah, that makes sense. So are all entrepreneurial opportunities then epistemologically objective, or are there some that are epistemologically subjective?
Yeah. So as near as we can tell, because they're social, they're all ontologically subjective, as I said. But unlike physical phenomena, on the epistemological side, it seems like they span a spectrum. Okay, so you've got, you know, one of my students' ideas to build a competing search platform for Google. The extent of the development of that idea is that they came to me and told me about it once. They haven't programmed anything, they haven't planned anything, they haven't, you know, filed articles of incorporation, right? So I would call that a highly subjective entrepreneurial opportunity. Now,
subjective in the epistemological sense.
Yeah, exactly. So highly epistemologically subjective opportunity. Now, you also have, say, you know, an opportunity, as we say, to purchase a, you know, McDonald's franchise, what would be referred to as a restaurant with some looseness.
Yes.
Now, is that epistemologically objective or subjective? Well, in that case, we have something that we can imagine has been around for 20 years. We have endless amounts of past sales data, customer data, demographics data. We've got protocols from McDonald's University. We've got support from McDonald's University. We know exactly what the franchise fees are and so on and so forth, right? So there is an incredible amount of objective data, you know, objective information and, you know, projections about sales and profits that are much, much more certain. I mean, they're always going to be uncertain to some degree, but they're much, much more certain than, you know, my student's idea to build a competing search platform or somebody's idea to start building a company that sells pet food on Mars.
Right. Okay.
So short answer is that they range on a spectrum and, you know, every opportunity is different. And it depends on the amount of objective, as we say, information about that opportunity.
Okay. I will file away the idea for the Martian pet food market.
Yes, you could be a millionaire.
Could be the pioneer of the Martian pet food market. Of course, I'm not sure which pets would be joining us on the trip to Mars. So I don't know whether it would be cat food or dog food or tardigrade food or.
Yeah, it's a blue ocean. We all want blue oceans, right?
Okay. Cool. So, okay. So now I think we have a clearer understanding of the paper itself. Who's the target audience for the paper? Who should read it?
You know, I'm the author, so I think everybody should read it. I think they should, you know, pass it out in preschool. I think it
or
should
at
be
least everybody. Doctoral seminars. Yeah.
Yeah. I think the first six pages should be read by everybody, especially people who don't agree with that basic approach to how to understand the social world. Because I think if you don't agree, it's really important. And, you should come up with an alternative account, you know, especially, you know, with the core idea that the physical world is mind independent and the social world is mind dependent. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, I've had people say that I'm against critical realism. And that's because I've had a couple of debates with critical realists who are friends of mine. I'm not, and there's some great critical realists, like Sayer wrote a book in 2000, where he has a very similar view to the core view, you know, that the social world is mind dependent, the physical world is mind independent, and handles the idea and develops it pretty subtly in all sorts of interesting ways. So I think for at least making progress on the ultimate goal of what I take to be the core goal for social ontology and critical realism, that is the development of a unified framework within which we can all work together to understand and make progress and advance knowledge about the social world. We've got to get clear about the basics first. So yeah, I hope everybody reads the first six pages. They're really easy.
Cool.
Then, you know, if you're interested in entrepreneurial opportunities, by all means, read the rest, of course.
Okay. So this is the origin series. I'm thinking point to the right part of my screen there. part of our agenda is to delve into the origins of the papers that are forthcoming in AMR for the purpose of demystifying the theory development process so that future authors can learn something from that and maybe get inspired, maybe see new avenues for theory development that they hadn't considered. So tell us a little bit about the origins of this project. How did the project get started in the first place? Where did you get the idea for it, et cetera?
Yeah, so I fear that I'm going to be terribly unhelpful here because my history is so terribly idiosyncratic. So I studied with John Searle at UC Berkeley for my PhD in philosophy and cognitive science, along with George Lakoff and Hans Schluge. And even though Searle was not the first one to start discussing social ontology, he's one of the people that has had the most influence, you know, so he's one of the grandfathers of social ontology. So I was exposed to it a long time ago. And back then I was only working on problems regarding the human mind, how the human mind works, or very much on the cognitive science side. And I was like, oh, this social stuff, it's so messy and it's such a pain. Like, I don't care about this. And then I got Rob Wuebker actually suggested that I come to the University of Utah and work with those guys on all sorts of problems in what I just saw as business. I didn't know anything about, you know, the different fields of management or strategy or entrepreneurship. And I was like, wow, that's the worst idea I've ever heard. You guys want to hire a philosopher to come to your business school? That sounds terrible, but I'll try out anything for a year or so. And it proved, you know, incredibly interesting. And the problems are incredibly messy. And there's a huge amount of theoretical work that still needs to be done. And so when Rob introduced me to this debate about entrepreneurial opportunities, I immediately thought, well, this falls squarely into social ontology, and so I should be able to do this one really quickly. But it was a very long process. I mean, from the time we first started working on the paper to the time it got published, it was, I don't know, 9 years or something, or wow, 8 years or something. I mean, the review process alone was almost 3 years. So it was, I thought it was going to be easy to apply basic ideas from theory that I was already familiar with. But the fact is, it doesn't help anybody if you just say, hey, here's a theory. You have to integrate it into, the stuff that they know, the theories right, that they know, right, the tools and techniques and stuff that they know. Otherwise, it's just some distant thing that they can't relate to. And doing that fine integration work is, it's slow work.
Right. So it sounds like Rob contributed the problem and you contributed the solution, and then you both worked on making that solution relevant to the audience. Is that fair?
Yeah, that's fair. I mean, we both worked on the paper, and the solution was just the core solution that the social world is mind dependent and the physical world is mind independent is, I can say that in 10 seconds, but applying it to an interesting problem in entrepreneurship, this debate between the creationists and the discovery theorists, that took us, a lot of work, and seems to inspire a lot of emotions on both sides. People get passionate about this, either because they think it's such a dumb problem, no one should be talking about it, or because they think it's so important and there's an obvious answer, and people aren't acknowledging that obvious answer.
Right.
So it's, for whatever reason, it seems to garner some emotions.
What made the project interesting enough for you to want to devote your time and effort to it?
Yeah, I think the project that I'm most fascinated by is the hardest one, and that is building a unified framework for understanding the social world for all the social sciences. So, not just social theory per se, but for sociology and social psychology and management, entrepreneurship and legal studies. I mean, there's amazing work that's been done in the study of law that relates to a lot of this stuff. So a lot of people from different fields within the social fields have been attempting to work on this in all sorts of different ways. And I think if we as humankind could come up with a unified theory of the social, that would just make for amazing, amazing progress in the future. That would be so much less hard fought and so much less difficult, because like the natural sciences, we'd have this, unified framework to work around, which makes, relying on other pieces of the framework so much easier and progress right, so much easier. So that's, that's what really motivates me. The debate itself is interesting. I don't think it's super helpful for actual entrepreneurship practitioners, except in a couple of ways. And so, I think if you, I guess, to, so the bottom line in which it's useful for practitioners is that if you have an established kind of entrepreneurial formula, like, oh, I'm going to open up another corner fruit stand, or I'm going to buy a franchise or something like that, then the discovery theorist approach of finding an opportunity and searching for an opportunity and analyzing opportunity makes a lot of sense. But to the degree that you're doing a 0 to 1, you know, as they say, or some very novel business, it's going to be very difficult to search for something that doesn't exist, right? So in the paper, we use the example of Airbnb. So the idea that individuals' rooms or homes could be a resource for the rest of the world to potentially rent was just an idea that didn't exist, right? And
It existed on Craigslist, you know, in a more scattered form, right? So it was not done as systematically. Certainly was not monetized as well.
I shouldn't have said didn't exist. It existed a little bit in a very unsystematized, scattered way. And the idea that it could be systematized and organized, and that eventually Airbnb would be the biggest hotel, you know, on the planet, was something that the venture capitalists thought was insane, right? I mean, what's one of the first things your mom told you, don't let strangers into your house. And so that idea as a legitimate business opportunity wasn't there. You know, it was created by these guys, and indeed they had to fight to change, you know, this pre-existing sentiment that most of us had about, you know, letting strangers into our house, or staying at a stranger's house, or staying in some stranger's bedroom of all things. And that took a lot of work and a lot of fight. And that wasn't the kind of thing that you're going to search for on the landscape of possibilities and discover. So one of the implications is that to the degree that your idea is more novel and doesn't exist on that landscape, you're not going to find it by, you know, searching for it.
Right. So it sounds like what really made the project interesting to you is that it provided one brick in the much larger wall that you would like to build, this, you know, big audacious goal of having a unified social theory.
Yeah. And I'm under no illusions that I'm going to build that wall, or even that all of us together working on that are going to build that wall in my lifetime, but I'd like to think we can in our lifetime. And there's some really smart people making a lot of really good progress on it. So if I had to recommend something.
It's one brick at a time, right? So gotta start somewhere. Absolutely. So you mentioned that the paper had been in some form or other for 9 years. So maybe can you take us through a little bit of that history about, for example, you know, how did the project develop from your original discussions with Rob about, you know, the entrepreneurial opportunity debate to an initial manuscript submission where you have, I mean, because simply having an idea that, oh, there's this debate about what is an opportunity, and oh, over here, there's a theory that could inform that debate. Let's put those two together, like the like in the old Reese's peanut butter cup commercial, you know, you got your chocolate on my peanut butter, right? Just simply recognizing the opportunity to combine peanut butter and chocolate is not a product. You have to take certain steps further to make it into a product. So likewise here, just simply recognizing the opportunity to bring that solution together with this problem is not a paper. There had to be some additional work to create it into a paper. So tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, I wish you had counseled me a little bit with some of those exact words at the beginning of the process, because I thought it was going to be a, you know, hey, let's drop the chocolate and the peanut butter and we're done.
Done, kind of thing.
So I, you know, we whipped together a paper in a couple of weeks. I just went straight through, you know, Searle's stuff, and I said, okay, here's real stuff, and you know, end of story. I hope you guys like my present I just gave you. And
but then, you know, there's things like packaging and advertising, yes, and etc. Yes.
Yeah, and you know, people like Bill Schultz at Utah said, well, you know, there's a bit of work here to be done. And Jay Barney was a little bit more straightforward. He was like, you are 17% of the way to a completed paper. And I thought this thing was going to be published like the next week. I was like, what? I refused to believe him. I was like, there's no possible way. It's, you know, maybe 98 or 99.2, but 70.
17 steps would mean that there's 6 parts and you've only done one.
Yeah.
And oh, actually, you had 5 parts.
In retrospect, that was an overstatement. It was probably more like 6%. So he actually understated his case, which I did not believe at all when he told me. But I forgot your question. Sorry.
Okay, what were the steps in the process to fill in that remaining, you know, percentage, whatever that percentage was, whether it was 90% or whatever.
Yeah. So the old adage, it's a marathon, not a sprint. I thought I was doing a sprint and it turns out I was doing a marathon. We were doing a marathon. So we just had to go back and I feel like it was extra hard for me because I came from a different field. And in that field in philosophy, what they like to see is very clear argumentation. So, you know, all men are mortal. Socrates is a man. Therefore, Socrates is mortal. And then you state why the premises are true and why the conclusion follows and you're done.
Right.
And the style in management is very different. Right. So, people want to see discussions around a topic. They want to see how things tie into other theories. They want lots of citations and integration. It took me a long time to, it took me a little while to get up to speed just on the discussions in the literature. So I knew what I was actually referring to in the first place, which Rob already knew. But it took the process of tying it into the relevant positions and the relevant theories and making it relevant to stuff that people were already familiar with, whether it was, you know, some of the critical realists or some other aspects of the debate. That was just a long, slow slog. And, you know, these days it's still a bit of a long, slow slog for me because I'm inclined to go, you know, premise, premise, conclusion. Thank you for reading my paper.
Indeed. Yes. I wish it were that easy. Yes. So, yes. So what were the biggest challenges that you faced? Was that it? Just simply finding a way to bridge the gap between the immaculate logic of the philosophical argument and the messy reality of business academia or
building the bridge was definitely the hardest part. I mean, doing so in an intelligent and, you know, kind of an informed manner and all the little threads, that was definitely the hardest part. And I definitely underestimated that. And what helped was presenting the paper as a talk about a million times. I mean, I think, you know, I listed some places on the paper where we delivered the talk, but
I saw the list of acknowledgments on the first page was quite extensive. Yes.
Yeah. And I forgot a bunch. And I think that's only about a third of them. Like I gave that talk everywhere, you know, all around the world that, you know, at least 24 different places.
Right.
And, you know, every time you do that, you get feedback on it. And I was really annoying with people whose feedback I wanted on the paper. And so I was continually shoving it in front of people's faces saying, hey, can you read this? You know, even if you just need something to fall asleep at night, just read it and give me some feedback on it. And that, you know, that helped a lot. Because there were reactions that people had, like, hey, you guys were being really obnoxious and you sound like, you know, you're know-it-alls and no one wants to read a paper from what sounds like a know-it-all. Like, oh, no, I didn't realize that. And, you know, so there are a lot of things you get when you get feedback from people who are experts in the field. And there's a lot of good feedback you get from just random people, you know, students or grad students at other schools when you present a talk. And so all that feedback and really connecting with the community and, you know, presenting this stuff at AOM conferences was all really useful for figuring out how to address problems and connect better and more thoroughly into concerns that people had.
So do you have, now I find, you know, with young researchers, they can have a bit of a challenge in distinguishing useful feedback and good feedback from useless feedback and you know, ego-driven feedback from people. How did you Do you have any advice for younger researchers on that? Because you're talking about having gathered just this massive amount of feedback. And so there must have been a filtering process that you went through to filter that down to, you know, what's the most relevant and most useful and helpful feedback?
Yeah, that's an incredibly good question. And I think even advanced scholars, you know, we get feedback from reviewers and we get, you know, contradictory feedback, you know, a lot of the time, and you have to, and these are from professional experts in that subfield, right? And so you have to figure out how you're going to navigate that. And that's part of the general problem you brought up about how do you establish a filtering mechanism on all this feedback you get. So what helped us, I think, was believing in the core idea that we were using, the core solution here that we thought helped dissolve or at least diminish a little bit the problem of the debate between the constructivists and the discovery theorists. So you held fast
to that core piece, even despite.
Yeah, we were committed to the. Sorry, say it again.
I'm sorry, you held fast to that core piece, even despite maybe recognizing the need to make changes on the periphery of the project.
Yeah, I wouldn't say periphery, but huge chunks of the body. But the basic idea, the tiny little basic idea, we believed in, and it survived, you know, with little criticism. There's still some criticism of that at various conferences and places where we presented it. As far as filtering goes, man, it's really it's a really interesting and hard question, and it's something that continues throughout your career as a scholar. It's difficult to distinguish, you know, you made some really interesting comments there about people who make comments because they're ego driven, like, hey, you didn't mention my field, or, you know, right. Hey, my theory is awesome and my theory says something about this, you know, why didn't you mention that? So some of that's easy to notice, and you have to just assess a little bit more independently whether, you know, that person's favorite tool or favorite concept or favorite theory really is useful and applicable to the problem you're going to solve.
Right.
And so that's a little bit easier, but, you know, what do you do when you're just getting into this, you're young, you've got conflicting remarks from two people you respect, and they're saying exactly the opposite thing. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, the only thing I can say is you've got to dig down and try and figure out why they're saying what they're saying.
Good point. Where are they coming from? What's the motivation behind the comment? Yeah, that's excellent.
Yeah.
That can help filter a lot of junk out, is to understand the motivation behind the comment, and maybe help to highlight the most important pieces of it. Like, was there any one or two pieces of feedback that you got and you thought, wow, you know, that's genius. I would never have thought of that. We really needed to hear that. That's going to improve the paper so much. And how did you recognize that? What was the tip that was such a good piece of feedback?
Yeah, I mean, the presentation of the paper evolved at pretty much every talk we gave as people responded to it in ways we hadn't anticipated. Was there kind of a singular, there's a really good comment from a grad student at ASADA. Mm-hmm. And when I gave a talk there, and I actually can't remember what it was, but I thanked them profusely, and that became part of the paper. There were about 100 times where Jay Barney said, "Hey, this is way too wordy. Like, tell me what you're going to tell me, and stop with all the pros and adjectives." So that was a common refrain on that front.
Good. Okay.
There are a couple others that were important, but I've forgotten at this point.
Okay. Fair enough. It's a surprise question. Not surprising that you didn't have a prepared answer for it. So, So tell us a little bit about, okay, so you talked a little bit about the process that took it from, okay, peanut butter and chocolate taste good together to, okay, we've got a product in a package with a brand name and a label, and we're submitting that to review for the journal. But even from that point, when once you've got a product on the shelf, that still doesn't necessarily sell, right? So there's a, you know, what, take us through the next step in the process where from the initial submission to AMR to the final manuscript that got accepted.
Yeah, it was a tough process. I will be honest, because we did get nearly completely contradictory responses from the reviewers.
Yeah. And that requires some skill for the editor to handle.
Yeah. And actually we submitted a paper that was really completely different. I mean, it's the same basic idea, but a completely different paper, you know, like year one, and it just got desk rejected. They said, this is, you know, this is terrible. And, you know, just after that is when Jay Barney said, yeah, it's like 17% done. So that's when I thought, oh, I have to, you know, I thought this was going to be easy just to knock out these papers, but I really have to slow down and approach this much more methodically. Before I answer your direct question, I do want to say one thing about kind of the practice of writing, right? So I can't remember if it was Frost or Himalaya who said, rule number one for writing, place ass in chair. So I think that's important. And it doesn't matter how you do it. I happen to like waking up and working on creative stuff as the very, very first thing I do before I make breakfast or deal with emails or go to a faculty meeting or anything else that kind of erodes my very limited and delicate creative brain power. So that's, if you approach it with like, hey, I'm going to try to get, you know, 2 creative hours of really good work. And then maybe a bunch of other time is spent doing, you know, reference citation hunting or other less creatively taxing work. You know, set tiny goals, and the consistency is far more important than the, you know, the sprinting.
Right. That reminds me of some famous fiction author, I don't know who it was, maybe it was Stephen King or somebody, I don't know, said that lots of people came up to him and said, oh, I want to write a book too, right? I want to write a book too. And he said, what they really mean is I want to have written a book. So they don't actually want to do the work necessary to sit down and write the book, research the book and write the book and develop the ideas and refine them and improve them and all the work that goes into it. Like Mario Puzo wrote that writing is rewriting, right? They want to have written a book, and it just doesn't work that way. You don't go from I've not written a book to I have written a book without actually doing the writing part in between.
Yeah. So. And along those lines, I can't resist offering another tip, if it's helpful, which is you have to be extraordinarily nice and friendly to yourself at the beginning of a manuscript, because you have to let yourself throw out all sorts of junk and just, you know, keep throwing out junk that's disorganized and not connected, and allow yourself to do that, to have something to work with so you can start the rewriting process. And not, you know, I have a mentor you know, one of my best friends, Bruce Mangan from Berkeley, who is incredibly difficult to write with, because he wants to write the paper exactly as a finished version, starting with sentence one.
Yeah,
two, good luck with that.
Yeah, that doesn't work for me. I don't know. How does he make that work?
Well, he's extraordinarily brilliant, and so he's able to pull it off a lot of the time. But if he works with anybody else, it's really challenging, because, you know, most people can't do that. And he, you know, he himself has a tough time finishing stuff because he can't get past that first sentence. No, that's not quite right. The preposition should be there. And, you know, so my suggestion is be very nice and friendly and receptive to yourself in the early stages. So getting back to the process, the review process was difficult. We had wildly conflicting reviews that were tough to navigate. We are pitching an incredibly broad idea about social reality itself, which is a tough sell, and immediately people's feathers come up because if they've been picked as a reviewer, they've got some opinion or other about this from their particular field. And so they're very interested in seeing their tools and their concepts and their theories being mentioned here. So we actually had, how did it work? I think we went through 6 reviewers. It was kind of an unusual case. Because we had 3 that we went through a couple of iterations with, and then there was a rough consensus, and then there was another 3 that we went through until they were mostly satisfied with it. I think 2 out of 3 were satisfied in the beginning, but I believe Dr. Alvarez really wanted to make sure that this was actually publishable and acceptable. So she brought another round of reviewers in. I think she had worked the first round so hard that she felt, it was only fair to bring in fresh brain.
Wow.
Yeah.
That is an unusual practice. I've not heard of that before. So,
yeah.
So how did you manage to get through all that?
It took an extraordinary amount of patience. I think there were a couple of tantrums that may or may not have been thrown by one or both of us as we navigated these waters. But really, we just tried to keep returning to the basic message of the paper. It's really easy to start adding all sorts of stuff, especially when you get responses where people are asking for all sorts of stuff to be included. But again, another useful filter is like, hey, does this really advance the core thesis of the paper? Yeah.
Indeed. Okay, well, let me close it out with one last question, which is, what impact do you hope this paper will have? Now, you already mentioned the potential impact on practice in the sense of, if it's more relatively objective, epistemologically objective opportunity, you take one approach versus another approach for the 0-to-1 case. But so that would be perhaps an impact on future practice. But what about impact on future theory, on future empirical research, maybe on future pedagogy, or perhaps even on future policy? Do you see any potential impacts on any of those areas?
Yeah, so my hope is that, you got to be realistic. There aren't as many people who are going to read your paper as you think there will be typically. But my hope is that people at least look at the beginning, and looking at the beginning gets them interested and excited and curious about the structure of social reality. And there are a number of people who have now gotten very interested in it and very interested in social ontology, including Dimo Dimov and Mike Ryle, who I was just talking to a couple of days ago, and Teppo Fallin, as well as people already doing work in social ontology. So I formed the Social Reality and Cognition International Research Group, which includes those people and others who are interested in it. And we hope to have some meetings and retreats and conferences where people can get together. And if they, got inspired by reading the beginning of this paper, that's great. But my hope is that they get interested enough to read something like Brian Epstein's book called The Ant Trap, or John Searle's Construction of Social Reality book, or Margaret Gilbert's paper called Walking Together, where she just spent the whole paper trying to explain what it means for two people to walk together, which sounds absurd, but it's a fascinating and really well done kind of case analysis of what a prototypical social entity, namely two people walking together, is. So if I can get people interested in questions about the structure of social reality, that would make me happy, because we need help. We need lots of people working on this stuff.
Terrific. Well, that's all the questions I have for today. But so thank you very much for joining us for the AMR Origin series, and I'm looking forward to seeing the paper in print. eventually, whenever the publication queue puts it up for print. And, you know, it's an excellent paper, and I do recommend it to everybody.
Oh, thanks. This was super fun for me. I didn't realize how much fun it would be. I will do this anytime again.
Great. Well, thank you.
And you're great at your job, too.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.